Hello, you're welcome to our recorded service here in St. Mary's in Crumlin for Sunday the 18th of July. And the weather is lovely, so you'll spot that I am wearing a few less layers than normal. And you may also spot the coloured stole because today we're going to celebrate Holy Communion. It's lovely to have you to share with me, with those of us who gather virtually for our celebration of Holy Communion today. We begin with our greeting. The Lord be with you and also with you. We pray the collect for purity together. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts be open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ says. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbour as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. Lord, have mercy on us, and write these your laws in our hearts. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to intercede for us in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us then confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned in thought and word and deed, and in what we have left undone. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may walk in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. May Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The collect for this Sunday, the seventh Sunday after Trinity. Lord of all power and might, the author and giver of all good things, graft in our hearts the love of your name. Increase in us true religion, and nourish us with all goodness, and of your great mercy, keep us in the same. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our first Bible reading today is from St. Paul's letter to the Ephesians chapter 2, beginning at the 11th verse. So then, remember that at one time, you Gentiles by birth, called the uncircumcision by those who are called the circumcision, a physical circumcision made in the flesh by human hands. Remember that you were at that time without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers to the covenant of the promise, having no hope, and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace. In his flesh, he has made both groups into one and has broken down the dividing wall, that is, the hostility between us. He has abolished the law with all its commandments and ordinances, so that he might create in himself one new humanity in place of the two, thus making peace, and might reconcile both groups to God in one body through the cross, thus putting to death that hostility through it. So he came, and he proclaimed peace to you who are far off, and peace to those who are near. For through him, both of us have access in one spirit to the Father. So then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are citizens with the saints, and also members of the household of God, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are built together, spiritually, into a dwelling place for God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our second hymn today is hymn number 528, The Church's One Foundation, hymn 528.
Thank you.
Hear the gospel of our Saviour Christ, according to St. Mark, chapter 6, beginning at the 30th verse. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. The apostles gathered around Jesus and told him all that they had done and taught. He said to them, "Come away to a deserted place by yourselves and rest a while." For many were coming and going, and they had no leisure even to eat. And they went away in a boat to a deserted place by themselves. Now many saw them going and recognized them, and they hurried there on foot from all the towns and arrived ahead of them. As Jesus went ashore, he saw a great crowd. He had compassion on them, for they were like sheep without a shepherd, and he began to teach them many things. When they had crossed over, they came to land at Gennesaret and moored the boat. When they got out of the boat, people at once recognized Jesus and rushed about that whole region and began to bring the sick on mats to wherever they heard he was. And wherever he went, into villages or cities or farms, they laid the sick in the marketplaces and begged him that they might touch even the fringe of his cloak. And all who touched it were healed. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray before we reflect on God's word together. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for Jesus, for who he is, for his life and teaching, for his death and resurrection. Help us to learn something more today about who we are in Christ as followers of Jesus. And make it real for us by your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Last week, we were reflecting on the structure of what we were reflecting about was on the story of King David bringing the Ark of the Covenant up to Jerusalem. And the Old Testament reading from Samuel was actually in two separate parts, but it was describing the celebrations of David bringing the Ark of the Covenant up to Jerusalem. And it was so important because it was a symbol of God's presence. It was a casket that held some of the manna and the tablets with the Ten Commandments and other things that spoke of God leading the people of Israel through the wilderness. And David was bringing it up to Jerusalem. And he was bringing it up in great celebration. We remember all the different instruments, but also at one level in great fear. And you saw that at every stage along the way, they stopped and made sacrifices just to keep things right. Because this ark was a symbol of God's power. The mighty power, the King of hosts, the King of glory. That King that we celebrated as we reflected on Psalm 24 last week, which was the psalm linked with that Old Testament reading. And that great sense of the celebration of the temple where God's presence is, the God who had created all the earth and where his presence lives. In the hundreds of years, the years before Jesus' birth, a new temple was built, the Temple of Herod. That's the temple that Jesus would have known. That's the temple that St. Paul would have known. And the Temple of Herod was on the same place as King Solomon's temple, on the same site of the Temple Mount in Jerusalem today, although the building on the mount is an Islamic building, but we see what we call the Wailing Wall, where you see where the Jewish people go to pray, and those massive stones. That gives you a little idea of the size of Herod's temple. Herod's temple was the largest building in the Roman Empire. And the temple had many different areas. There's a reason I'm telling you all of this. It'll come in a few minutes. So the temple had many different areas, or the outside parts were called the courts. So if you went in through the gates into the temple first, there was this large area which was called the court of the Gentiles. Now Gentiles Most of us, I'm guessing, are Gentiles by birth. We are non-Jewish people. Gentiles had the outside court. The Jewish people believed that God had called them, but he's the God of the whole world. And God had called them not just to have a special relationship with this God of the whole earth, but that they were meant to reach out into the whole world and tell the rest of the world about God. So Gentiles should be coming to worship. But Gentiles were not part of the covenant, the commitment between God and the people of Israel, made in the wilderness and recommitted again and again through the generations of the people of Israel. The next court in was the court of the women. Next best thing to being the total outsiders are the women. And women were allowed to come here and were allowed to pray there. Beyond that then was the court of the men. And the Jewish men gathered to pray in that court. And then beyond that was the area for the priests, and only priests could go there. And finally, at the centre of the temple, no longer with the Ark of the Covenant, but still with this sense of being this centre point, being a special place, a place where God was specially present, called the Holy of Holies. And it was so holy that ordinary, sinful human beings couldn't go into the Holy of Holies. Only on one day a year. Well, only on certain occasions, let's put it that way. There were certain occasions through the year where a priest could go in and make the special sacrifices. And the Holy of Holies was right in the centre towards the back of the temple, and there was this very, very thick, very, very heavy curtain in front of the Holy of Holies. So there's all these different layers between the Holy of Holies, the symbolic place of God's presence, and those who came to worship God. And the further you go out, the further you away from the experience of the presence of God. And the dividing wall between the court of the Gentiles and where the Israelites could go had, well, Josephus, the Jewish historian, tells us about it, but they actually found, in excavations, they found one of the plaques that was on the wall between the Gentile space and where the Jewish could worship. And it says this: "Let no one of any other nation come within the fence and barrier around the holy place. Whosoever will be taken doing so will himself be responsible for the fact that his death will ensue. Now, it's called here a fence and a barrier, but Josephus describes a big, tall wall. A big, tall wall that divides the Gentiles from the Jewish people. And then there's another wall that divides the worshipping women from the worshipping men. And there's another wall between the worshipping men and the priests. And a curtain between the priests and the active presence of God. And then we read in our epistle reading today, Paul is writing to the church in Ephesus. And almost all, if not all of the people in this church, were not born Jewish. That's important. It was a big issue for the early church. Was Jesus sent just for the Jewish people? But they believed, no. They could understand that Jesus was sent for the people of the world. But did all the peoples of the world have to become Jewish to become followers of Jesus? And it was a major battle. And in Acts chapter 15, it tells us that there was a big gathering of the leaders of the early church in which, in prayer and discussion, they believed God said, no, the Gentile followers of Jesus did not need to become Jewish and keep the Jewish laws. And that's true of us today. We don't keep the ritual laws. We don't have to enter into that covenant. We believe there's a new covenant come to us through Jesus. But Paul is writing to this Gentile church in Ephesus, this church which, if they were coming to worship the Jewish God, would have to stay outside this dividing wall. They could not come into the presence of God in the temple. So what does Paul say to them? In Christ Jesus, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ, by Jesus' death on the cross, his blood paying the sacrificial price that was within the Jewish ritual of sacrifice. For Jesus is our peace. In his flesh, he has made both groups, both the Jewish people and the Gentiles, both groups into one, and has broken down the dividing wall that is the hostility between us. So that wall between the worshipping Jews and the worshipping Gentiles, it's gone in Jesus. But is it just that wall between the Jews and the Gentiles that's gone in Jesus? We think about all the different walls that are in that layout of Herod's temple. If I can find a picture, I'll put it up on the video. Surely, in the story of Good Friday, when Matthew tells us that when Jesus died, the curtain in the temple, where was the curtain? The curtain was at the front of the Holy of Holies, where God's presence most powerfully was. That curtain was ripped. Big, thick curtain. That couldn't be done by humans. That curtain was ripped from the top to the bottom. God had broken the dividing wall. Not just between the Jews and the Gentiles. Not just between the men and the women. Not just between the ordinary worshipping people and the priests, but between God and all of humanity. God had ripped it, because in Jesus' death, and proven in his resurrection, but in Jesus' death, God had cleansed and made possible for all of us to be cleansed from our sin. So that all of us could come to the presence of the living God. Not just one priest on very special days. Not just a man. Not just a woman. Not just a Jewish person. But all of us. No matter how far we may have been from God all our lives. In Jesus, God makes peace. And offers to each of us the opportunity to come and to worship. To come and to meet with God. Paul continues, so then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are citizens with the saints. Saints in the Bible doesn't just mean the particularly holy ones. Anyone who's a follower of Jesus gets the claim of saint or holy one, one dedicated to God in the scriptures. But you are citizens with the saints and also members of the household of God, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Jesus Christ himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are being built together spiritually into a dwelling place for God. Paul has been referring, in a gentle way, to the divisions within the physical building of the temple that excluded, particularly the Gentiles. God had broken that barrier down. And when Jesus was writing, Herod's temple still was physically there. But Jesus had said, before he died, that he would tear the temple down and rebuild it in 3 days. And Paul and us as followers of Jesus believe that in Jesus is the true temple now. That we as followers of Jesus are built together into a temple of worship. Not a building, but a community. And I'm going to put up a picture that I came across yesterday, and it's just so powerful, and it says, church is not something you go to, it's a family you belong to, even if you can't come physically. And I hope you can, but if you can't, you're still part of the family. even if you're not in the physical building. Because church, like the temple that Paul is talking about here, is not a physical building. It's a family, a community built together in Christ. So, what is Paul saying to us today? What he's saying first, and I didn't go into too much detail about the first part of that Bible reading, but what he's saying to us first is, it doesn't matter who you are, it doesn't matter where you've been born, it doesn't matter what you look like, it doesn't matter what you sound like, it doesn't matter whether you were born within the Jewish people, within the Gentiles, you're born a man or a woman, whether you're a priest or an ordinary person, well, you know what I mean. It doesn't matter who you are. In Christ, all of us are invited to come before God in worship. All of us are invited before the face of God in the Holy of Holies. Christ has taken down that barrier between each other and between us and God. Maybe you feel that barrier is real there. Maybe you feel that distance from God. Maybe you've always felt it, or maybe you particularly feel it at the moment. Scripture teaches us that all of us as human beings are sinful, are broken, we are imperfect. We do not live up to the glory or the way of love that God calls of us. And because we are impure and imperfect, we cannot come before the face of a holy God. That's why there was all those layers within the physical temple, Herod's temple. But in Christ's death, that curtain is torn. And as we come acknowledging our sin, Lord Jesus Christ, we are sorry for all that we have done wrong. We are sorry for living lives that are not following your way. By your death and resurrection, forgive my sin. I choose to seek to follow and live your way. And Paul says of all of us, when we say that prayer, and we are built together into a community of worship. And we come before the face of God by the power of the Holy Spirit. You can. I can. All of us. Christ is our peace. Peace with God. Peace with one another. We are commanded to love God and to love one another. No matter who the other is, if they too love God, they are your brother or sister in Christ. We are being united together in one family. And whether you're physically here in church, or whether you're virtually here sharing in this worship, you are part of God's church. And God's family, you are welcomed before the holy God in Jesus' name. And we gather in our worship together. Let's pray. Lord God, last week we heard of David's celebrations at the bringing of the Ark of the Covenant up to Jerusalem. And in those celebrations, in that joy of bringing your presence to his city, he stopped again and again in sacrifice because he knew of his sinfulness, because he was afraid of the holy God. And in Herod's temple, there were all these different barriers between all of us and your presence, O God, because you are a holy God and we're not. But we praise you that in Jesus' death and in his resurrection, you have ripped that barrier between us and you and between us, one another, so that you are, we have your peace. We have peace with you, peace with one another, peace in ourselves. We ask in the name of Jesus, by the power of your Holy Spirit, living in us as your followers, that you would make real to us at this time of worship and in our everyday lives your presence with us, your power and your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Trying to find my prayer book. Let's continue in prayer. Let us pray. Blessed are you, Lord God. All that is within us blesses your holy name, for you forgive all our sins. You heal all our infirmities. You save our life from destruction. You bring peace. Peace in our hearts and lives, and peace between us. Blessed are you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. We give you thanks for your church throughout the world. We pray that your church, wherever it may be a community, a family that seeks to share in your healing and bring peace. We remember before you all who are priests, all who are leaders in your church. And we pray that they may seek always to be those who bring healing and restoration and peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord our God, we give you thanks for all who are in leadership throughout our world, especially those who govern and care for others for their own best interests. We ask your blessing on all who are decision makers in our world, especially in these difficult COVID times. We pray for those who are decision makers within government, within the health services, within science and business, within NGOs and those who support others in need. We pray that you would bless the work of the World Health Organization. We pray that you would bless the work of the UNHCR and all the many international organizations, including Medicine Sans Frontières, who seek to bring healing in places of such destruction and sadness and pain. And we pray for the many individuals and families who in times of crisis reach out to bring hope and support. We pray also for our own communities, and we thank you for all who look out for one another, especially those in need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give you thanks, O Lord, for our homes, our families, our loved ones. We pray for those with whom there might be walls of division and hurt and pain. We pray for those who find it hard to be together as family, as community. And we pray that we may seek peace in safety and security. We pray for all those who are separated from their loved ones, particularly through times of illness or through the divisions of this COVID season. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In a time of quiet, we bring our own particular prayers and concerns before God. Lord our God, we pray, not just for ourselves, but for all those who are in any form of need or trouble. We pray for those who are ill, for those who care for them, and for their loved ones. May each know your healing and your peace. Merciful God, accept these our prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that he may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name, and we share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. How can I repay the Lord for all the benefits he has given me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. Father, almighty and ever-living God, at all times and in all places, it is right to give you thanks and praise. And so with all your people, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed are you, Father, the creator and sustainer of all things. You made us in your own image. Male and female, you created us. Even when we turned away from you, you never ceased to care for us. But in your love and mercy, you freed us from the slavery of sin, giving your only begotten Son to become man and to suffer death on the cross to redeem us. He made there the one complete and all-sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. He instituted and in his holy gospel commanded us to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death until he comes again. On the night that he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks to you, he gave it to the disciples, saying, Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Therefore, Father, with this bread and this cup, we do as Christ your Son commanded. We remember his passion and death. We celebrate his resurrection and ascension, and we look for the coming of his kingdom. Accept through him, our great high priest, this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts, grant by the power of the life-giving Spirit that we may be made one in your holy church and partakers of the body and blood of your Son, that he may dwell in us and we in him, through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever. Amen. Using the traditional words, as our Saviour Christ has taught us, so we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom,